ways to respond to every inconvenience in your life.
Okay, so I'm vacuuming the house. My husband was just here for lunch, and he had lunch with us and then a shake. And I guess he sat in this rocking chair and left his cup there. I am now faced with a dilemma. What do I make of this? Do I get all bitter in my head, thinking evil thoughts like, I can't believe he left this cup here, doesn't he know I'm vacuuming? Or, he always does this, I can't believe he can't just put it in the sink. Or, call him and tell him all sorts of crushing, discouraging, unloving things like, when you're done drinking your shake, put your cup in the sink. Don't just leave it on the floor for me to pick up or whatever. Or I can say, oh, Hector left his glass here. Let me go put it in the kitchen for him. He's such a great husband to work so hard for us every day. I'm so glad he came home for lunch today. And I'm glad he finished the shake because I know it's packed with nutrients. And he's going to be full for a long time now. Back to vacuuming. Your choice, ladies. Be miserable or be happy.
So, which way do you respond when you are inconvenienced? Do you respond with some form of gratitude, with a positive attitude, or are you bitter and angry? Once again, our good buddy Rick Thomas helps us diagnose ourselves. If you are struggling with virtually any emotional issue, I cannot strongly recommend and encourage you to visit rickthomas.net. Use the search engine. Put in your issue, whether it's anger, whether it's disappointment. The issue is abuse. You are struggling with guilt, whatever it is. Type it into the search engine and start reading, and Rick Thomas will help you understand yourself. If and you happen to be an individual who is angry, Rick Thomas is going to open up the hood of your life, and this might reveal a bit of a surprise to you, the motivation for your anger. Please note, if this is describing you, we do not provide any Band-Aids here. There will be no balm, just a paper cut with some lemon juice poured in it. Are you ready? Here we go. Did you know the angry man or woman is probably a scared person too? Most sinful anger, because there is righteous anger, most sinful anger is born out of insecurity. This person is fearful. He's not going to get what he wants. So she or he uses anger as a manipulative means to make sure his craving heart is satisfied. Ow, that kind of stung. If you struggle with sinful anger, not being upset that God's name is being slandered or that his word is being twisted, contorted, and abused, if you're mad at people a lot, your issue underneath your presenting sin is the sin of fear. It looks a little something like this. You want something to happen that is good for you. And when that doesn't happen, because you're afraid that it won't happen, you use anger to get your way. Think back. Does that sound like the behavior of an adult, or does that possibly sound like the behavior of a child? I told you there would be some paper cuts and lemon juice involved in this. Rick Thomas said this: the angry man is a bigger version of the kid sitting on the floor throwing a tantrum, manipulating others to get what he wants. It's the same anger born out of a similar insecurity, fear. I want this to happen. I want it to be this way. I fear it won't happen because I need it to be like this. I'm scared of the result if it doesn't go down my way. Therefore, out of insecurity, out of fear, you go about the business of murdering. That's exactly what James describes in James chapter 4. Why do we fight? Because you think you need something, you're afraid you're not going to get something, doesn't happen the way that you want it to happen, and then you go to war and you're willing. It looks more mature than a kicking and stomping tantrum that we see all the time these days in Walmart. Nevertheless, it can be mature. It doesn't even need to be yelling. But if anger comes out of you in any way, shape, and form, underneath that anger is nothing but fear. Let's keep diagnosing, shall we? Sinful anger has a twist of irony. This person appears to be strong and in charge by blustering. His bellowing convinces you of his power. The truth is that the angry man is weak. That doesn't mean that he's weak. You know, like, he doesn't have the sort of guns that I possess. That's not the type of weakness that is being described here. Physical weakness is off the table. That's irrelevant. We're talking about spiritual strength here. The angry person has no spiritual strength to get that sinful response under control. Did I mention anything about paper cuts and lemon juice? It is the weak person spiritually who has not emptied him or herself in increasing measures of him or herself to be under the control by the power of the Holy Spirit. Uh-oh. Does that describe you? Number two from Rick. The angry person is broken. This person could indeed be hurting. They are a needy person. They have been wounded, perhaps, in the past. We should be sensitive to that, totally aware of that, but that is no excuse for manifesting sinful anger when we don't get what we want. And finally, this from Rick. The angry man is insecure. Not satisfied with anything, because I'm satisfied not with self, like the secular psychologists would say, but I am satisfied because I am in Christ. And I don't need things to go my way, because I am content that they go His way. Thank you very much for watching Something Wretched. If you would like to continue watching Wretched videos, would you be kind enough to become a Wretched Club member? Your monthly support keeps us on the air, and you get lots of tchotchkes and benefits. Learn more at wretched.tv/club.